Friends, good evening. Wow, I'm hot tonight. Woo! Are we all as excited as I am? Well, it's Good Friday, and today is the day that we remember that our Lord Jesus lowered himself, submitted his body to terrible torture so that he could deliver us from the weight of sin and the penalty of it. Tonight, we're having what's called a Tenebrae Service, and I've encouraged all of you to sit in the middle so that you can see, and each one of these candles corresponds to a different word, and those words will also be put up on the screen as well as we read. We have several readers tonight, and so we're going to spend a whole lot of time in Scripture tonight, and I'm going to kick us off, but before we do, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for this night that we remember that your Son hung on a cross. That Jesus bore your wrath so that we wouldn't have to. Jesus, thank you for your willingness. Thank you that you humbled yourself, that you didn't call 10,000 angels to deliver you from this day, but that you willingly did so all for love. So, Father, as we read tonight, as we hear and we remember, I pray that we might be changed, that today wouldn't just simply be Good Friday, but it would be the day that changes our life forever, that starts a brand new one. Jesus, help us to become the kind of follower that is willing to pick up their cross and follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our first reading tonight comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 26. And when Jesus was in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor." But when Jesus was aware of it, he said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a good work for me. For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her." Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him to you?" And they counted him out 30 pieces of silver. So from that time, he sought opportunity to betray him.
Now on the first day of the feast of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.' So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When the evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now as they were eating, he said, 'Assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me.' They were exceedingly sorrowful, and each of them began to say to them, 'Lord, is it I?' He answered and said, 'He who dippeth his hand with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, "Rabbi, is it I?" He said to him, "You have said it."
We're going to sing a hymn now.
Trampled on the ground, you took. Have mercy on me, O Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye wastes away with grief. Yes, my soul and my body. For my life is spent with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my iniquity, and my bones waste away. I am in reproach among all my enemies, but especially among my neighbors, and am repulsive to my acquaintances. Those who see me outside flee from me. I am forgotten like a dead man, out of mind. I am like a broken vessel. For I hear the slander of many. Fear is on every side. While they take counsel together against me, they scheme to take away my life. But as for me, I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are my God.
Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to be troubled and deeply depressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch." He went a little further and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will." Then he came and found them sleeping and said, "Peter, Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again he went away and prayed and spoke the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. Then he came the third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Is it enough? The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Mark 14:43-59. And immediately while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude, with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now his betrayer had given them a signal, saying, "Whomever I kiss, he is the one. Seize him and lead him away safely." As soon as he had come, immediately he went up to him and said to him, "Rabbi, Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid their hands on him and took him. And one of those who stood by drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to take me? I was daily with you in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me, but the scriptures must be fulfilled." Then they all forsook him and fled. Now a certain young man followed him, having a linen cloth thrown around his naked body, and the young men laid hold of him. And he left the linen cloth and fled from them naked. And they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes. But Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and all the council sought testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but found none. For many bore false witness against him, but their testimonies did not agree. Then some rose up and bore false witness against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands.'" But not even then did their testimonies agree.
Immediately in the morning, the chief priest held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. And they bound Jesus, led him away, and delivered him to Pilate. Then Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of Jews?" He answered and said to them, "It is as you say." And the chief priest accused him of many things, but he answered nothing. Then Pilate asked him again, saying, "Do you answer nothing? See how many things they testify against you?" But Jesus still answered nothing, so that Pilate marveled. Now at the feast, he was accustomed to releasing one prisoner to them, whoever they requested, and that was one named Barabbas, who was chained with his fellow rebels. They had committed murder in the rebellion. Then the multitude, crying aloud, began to ask him to do just as they had always done for them. But Pilate answered them, saying, "Do you want me to release you to the king of the Jews?" For he knew that the chief priest had handled him over because of envy. But the chief priest stirred up to the crowd so that he should rather release Barabbas to them. Pilate answered and said to them again, "What then do you want me to do with him, who you call the King of Jews?" So they cried out again, "Crucify him!" Then Pilate said to them, "Why, what evil has he done?" But they cried out all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and he delivered Jesus, and he had scorned him to be crucified.
La gente se acercaba para ver a quién llevaba aquella cruz. Por la vía dolorosa, que es la vía del dolor, como oveja vino Cristo, Rey y Señor, y fue él quien quiso ir por su amor. Por ti, por mí, por la vía dolorosa al Calvario y a morir. The blood that would cleanse the souls of all men made its way through the heart of Jerusalem. Like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King, and he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the
Who has believed our report? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray and have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Let's sing together. Will you stand as we sing?
Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole garrison around him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And when they had twisted a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Then they spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they took the robe off of him, put his own clothes on him, and led him away to be crucified. Now as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. Him they compelled to bear his cross. And when they had come to the place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." Sitting down, they kept watch over him there. And they put up over his head the accusation written against him, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and another on the left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads and saying, "You who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests also, mocking with the scribes and elders, said, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he is the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe in him." He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, "I am the Son of God."
Friends, when we hear this horrific account, we remember the night before when Jesus broke bread. And tonight we get to break bread together and remember that this sacrifice was not in vain. When we read that the sour wine was mixed with gall, sometimes we can just go right past that because some of us don't know what gall is and why he would dismiss it. But gall was meant to pacify the criminal. It would alleviate the struggle in some way, but we remember that Jesus gave up his life willingly. There was no refusal in him. He did not struggle against the soldiers' hands and against the nails. It was willingly. And so we remember tonight that this sacrifice for our sake was done on purpose and with such love. His body was broken for us, and his blood poured out, the blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for me and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Tonight we share in this most holy meal on the very night that we remember that he was crucified, suffered, and died. So please come and receive from the Lord's table. It is set and ready. Come as you are able. Kevin, the body of Christ. Larna, the body of Christ. I'm so sorry about your ear. Judson, the body of Christ, broken for you. Nancy, the body of Christ, broken for you. Brian, the body of Christ, broken for you. Father, as we received from your table tonight, we are reminded of this precious gift. Jesus, we owe you everything. Our lives are yours. Our hearts are yours, Jesus. Tonight we give them to you anew, remembering that as you carried the cross, as you were beaten, as you were scourged, your mind was never changed. You loved. So Jesus, even on this night that we remember your death on this side of the cross, it's hard not to feel the immense joy. That same joy that you felt, Lord Jesus, as you made your way to that place. So, Father, I ask that you would help us all to cherish the cross just as you did. You died so that we might live. Help us to live to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Friends, let's stand and sing.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it one day for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so a wondrous beauty I see. For 'twas on that old cross Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday through my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling for a crown and exchange. crown.
Please be seated.
Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now the tunic was without seam, woven from the top in one piece. They said therefore among themselves, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" Therefore the soldiers did these things. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing by, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, "I thirst." Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on hyssop and put it to his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished," and bowing his head, gave up his spirit.
Friends, as Beth comes to read now, when the last candle is extinguished, we're all going to leave in silence, okay?
"Therefore, because it was the preparation day, that the bodies should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. And he who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, so that you may believe. For these things were done that the scripture should be fulfilled, 'Not one of his bones shall be broken.' And again, another scripture says, 'They shall look on him who they pierced.' And after this, Joseph Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took the body of Jesus. And Nicodemus, who at first came to see Jesus by night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds. Then they took the body of Jesus and bound it in strips of linen with spices, and the custom of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been laid. So there they laid Jesus, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the tomb was nearby.